last part of simulation all about polycrystal plasticity is going to be another application, which is forming limit. Sheet metal is one of the most important material, and its formability is always tested. We are always looking for developing materials with high formability. And of course, the simulations help in understanding that what aspect should be improved for formability of a sheet. Whether it is the strain hardening capacity of the material which should be improved, or the texture, the R values. So different, also the quality of the sheet, whether it is really very, very uniform. So I'm going to present you here one of the most successful modeling technique for sheet forming, which is based on a defect theory. Probably you know also that presentation of the measuring the strains on a sheet. In the early times, when a sheet was deformed, then different testings were applied to reach all kinds of deformation modes, like biaxial stretching, stretching in two directions, or just uniaxial stretching. Usually the combination of these two, uniaxial stretching and biaxial stretching, cover all deformation modes which are important in sheet metal forming. And then the so-called forming limit diagram, or shortly called FLD, is constructed by measuring the actual strains on the material just before or during the before rupture. The technique is usually that we put circles on the surface of the sheet, and after deformation, well, they change their aspect ratio, and from the aspect ratio of the ellipse we can calculate from the change with respect to the initial size, we can calculate the strain. Two strains, major strains, are calculated, and they are perpendicular, the so-called major strain and the minor strain. And then they are plotted. So we make a diagram in which the major strain and the minor strains are plotted. And usually we have something like this kind of curve. Below these strains, in this region, the deformation is stable. But when we arrive to this line, then a localization is developing in the material, and that is fracture. So we cannot reach the strain region, which is here. So this kind of FLD, forming limit diagram, is showing the formability capacities of the capacities of the material. Of course, the aim is to shift this curve the higher possible, so that the material doesn't break and then shows high capacities of deformation. So how can we simulate that when we want to take into account also how texture plays a role in this? I'm going to present here the so-called Marciniak-Kosinski model or approach, in which an initial defect is assumed on the surface of the sheet. There are other approaches, for example, the so-called perturbation theory, in which I also made simulations. We have no time for that, and that is much more mechanics, includes much more mechanics. So I'm choosing this one, which will show already, and this is successful simulation, the main effects in terms of textures. So an initial defect is assumed on the surface of the sheet. If this is the XY reference system, then this is the groove, which is in which it is assumed that there is a slight decrease, deviation from uniform thickness, a small one. And the angle of this groove with respect to the sheet is unknown. We imagine, we expect that they can be in any direction on the surface of the material. So it's a variable. We have to optimize it to find to which angle the deformation is the least, to find the minimum value, which is still safe for the material. So actually, in this forming process, we have two zones. One is the sheet itself, A, and the other is the B, is the groove. So we have to write some mechanics equations to examine the compatibility, to write compatibility equations and also stress equilibrium equations, which permit us to predict the deformation in B. So deformation in the zone A on the whole sheet is imposed by the testing, biaxial testing or tensile testing. And then, assuming knowing only the thickness of this initial groove and taking an orientation, we have to obtain what are the strains within the groove. So we need stress strain response within the B and also within the A. In both regions, we use polycrystal plasticity. It is possible to use polycrystal plasticity, and then we have the most general simulation possible. So this is the configuration. Now let's see what kind of equations we can write for making relations between the two zones. So A, everything which is in A is the imposed the sheet quantities. So in this reference system, on the groove, we put a direction 1 perpendicular to the groove and direction 2 parallel to the groove. The compatibility equation implies one relation only, that the strain in direction 2 has to be equal in the two zones. Otherwise, if they are not equal, the groove could not be maintained. The length of the groove is the same in room in phase A and phase B, the length itself. It cannot be smaller in one and longer in the other. So that involves that the length change which is happening and that in direction 2 has to be equal, and it would not change the geometry of the groove. It will remain in the same direction. So one equation is at the 2-2 component, which is the strain in direction 2, this kind of tensile strain or compression, is the same in both phases. That's the so-called compatibility equation for this problem. The other would be the equilibrium. Of course, forces are transmitted from one zone to the other, and this transmission of forces permits us to write again relations between the two zones. So what do we do? A force which is perpendicular in direction 1 here across the zone is transmitted from zone A to zone B. That's the sigma 1-1 component of the stress state. So if I multiply it with the thickness HA, then I get a force, and I do the same in the zone B. Again, the force in the same direction, they have to be equal, force equilibrium. This is the normal force which is transmitted across the zone. Now there is also another condition here for the stress we have too, is that if there is a shear force parallel to direction 2 with normal 1, so this is a stress component which is actually sigma 1 2 or sigma 2 1. The two are is the same, sigma 1 2 sigma 1 2 equal sigma 2 1. So the shear force is also transmitted along the groove. That gives us this equation. So we have three equations which we can use. Let's examine now what is the stress state on the material. This is a sheet. We do not apply in the thickness any forces. We also, in this testing, we do not impose shear components. So the stress tensor of the sheet forming is this so-called plane stress state. Plane stress means that forces are only happening in the plane 3 in direction 1, 2. This stress component can happen, but there is no stresses in the normal direction, and then no shear stresses applied also in the sheet. So we have here 1, 2, 3 unknowns. This is equal to that, so 1, 2, and 3, which has to be determined. What the stress in crystal plasticity, when we neglect the elastic constants and elasticity of the material is not calculated, then we only have the deviatoric stress state, because the spherical stress here, one component of the imposed stress, is not working in plasticity. So we only use the stress deviatoric tensor. So in the following, we are going to use Sij, and the boundary condition that this component has to be zero gives us that the stress state what we apply on the material in terms of deviatoric stress component will be S12, S21, the difference of S11, S33, and the difference of S22 minus S33. This relation comes from here. This has to be zero. Sigma 33 has to be zero. Then we get S33. From this relation, we also have to calculate that one. And then, finally, getting this zero, we get the full stress state in terms of deviatoric stress. So that's the stress state. Only three components are necessary to know, to calculate. Now, for simplicity, here isotropic hardening was done for the evolution of the material hardness. Initially, here we basically want to describe how the yield surface is increasing during a plastic strain. So we take an initial stress state, and we are going to homothetically increasing the size of the magnitude of the stress in all directions where needed in an isotropic way. So then we can describe the hardening state of the material with a reference strength value, tau c, which we are going to make evolving with strain. This equation here is very widely used. This is a so-called Swift equation of strain hardening. It is strain rate sensitive. So here is strain rate sensitivity. Epsilon dot is the von Mises equivalent strain rate. M is the strain rate sensitivity. These are strain. This is the imposed strain of the material. This is a constant. and n is the so-called strain hardening exponent. Usually it is kept constant. And this is a constant, and this is also another constant. Now, we are going to take into account texture evolution. We just have to impose the velocity gradient tensor. So I will show how this can be done. Right. We have to impose basically the strain part. By doing such a testing on the whole sample, we impose the displacements. So we impose the deformation components. Like, for example, in two directions, so x minor strain and then y major strain, we can describe a proportional strain path by taking the ratio of y deformation component divided by the x. And this parameter fixes how the strain is imposed on the whole sheet. That's the testing. We can impose different rho values. Rho equal 1 is the maximum, because after this would become the major strain, but major strain we always put on that one, so rho goes up to only maximum, only 1. And once we choose to impose this strain path on the matrix, which is A, then the B, the strain components in the B, will be calculated with the help of the response of the material and the strains calculated in the bulk. And here is a plot of a real simulation which shows how the deformation is developing in the groove. While we impose here, for example, equiaxial, biaxial stretching on the sheet, and we assumed that in the groove the deformation, the thickness is slightly smaller, only just 1% smaller, then progressively the deformation is deviating in the groove, and at a given moment it becomes vertical, becomes plane strain, meaning that only this strain component is increasing, the other one is not increasing anymore. The deformation localizes in the groove. The speed of the velocity of the deformation becomes high, so that in short time here, the deformation is localizing so much in the groove that there is fracture, localization. This is always the case. When this is happening, then deviation is taking place between the groove and then the sheet, and then it becomes always kind of vertical within the groove, and then we take the strain, limit strain, when it becomes vertical, and then we say this is the limit strain in the sheet. So this is the technique. The simulation gives the strain path within the groove. This is possible because fully imposing here for the sheet, fully imposing the deformation, we get the stress. And with the help of the equations for the equilibrium, which we wrote here, these two equations, we get the necessary stress components also in the groove. And then knowing the stress components and one component here for the strain, from mixed boundary conditions applying here in the groove, mixed boundary conditions, we impose that one in the polycrystal code. And then we can follow solving this problem. We obtain the unknown stress components. Here this is sigma 2,2. and also all the unknown strain components. And knowing the strain components, we can detect when deformation is localizing within the groove. So this is the technique which is working very nicely for modeling with polycrystal plasticity. During the testing, actually we can also represent that we are on the yield surface for the bulk material. Also for the other, but the situation is different between the two. Let's say we are here. This is axis 1, and this is axis 2, or x and y. So we deform the material in this direction and in that direction with this kind of strain rate vector. You see, let's say biaxial stretching here, equibiaxial. Then where this vector is touching our yield surface, the polycrystal yield surface, then this is the stress state which it belongs to. When we do crystal plasticity, we always look for this point on the yield surface. We know this, and then we get that one. Then we have the full solution, stress and strain. Or we know some components of this, complementary components of that, and still we can determine this point. And then we have the full solution. Now, this is the situation in the sheet, in the bulk, but within the groove, it's different. The groove is deforming more. It is hardening more because there is more strain in it. So it's on another yield surface, the groove solution. It is approaching this plane strain solution. When there is only one strain component, the other component is zero. And this would be the corresponding stress state. So you see there are different stress states in the two zones, different strain rates. But with the help of our basic equations, we can make the relation between them and solve for the full. The equilibrium equation with our notations we introduced, thickness of the sheet, thickness of the groove, and then the strength of the material, and then the stress state. This is the equilibrium equation, is the same which we already wrote, but with our notation for our crystal plasticity simulation. Okay. Now, let me show you the effects, how much effect can happen, which zones of the FLD will be affected by actually texture evolution. This needs to be found out. So the example which I am treating here concerns an aluminium sheet which was treated differently to obtain different textures. So one texture was having quite a nice strong cube component. These are 1-1-1 pole figures. This is the rolling direction, previous rolling direction of the sheet, and previous TD. So you see that these positions here indicate the so-called cube orientation of the texture. It's very frequent in aluminium sheets. Usually this is what we have, because after rolling an aluminium sheet, annealing is needed to recover its formability, and during annealing, this component appears in aluminium. With a bit of chance, not only this component appears, here there's another example, this component is there, but together with a fiber, with a rotated cube fiber. So So the fiber texture can also appear in the same material with different combination of strain, rolling, and heat treatment. The same material, another texture. So there is the cube, as you can see, the four reflections. But also, large intensity can happen if we rotate that cube around the RD axis. This is the so-called cube fiber with RD axis. That's also very frequently observed. These are materials which are used in commercial applications. Or this is more difficult to get here when the cube component is much less strong, and you can see that there is a rotated cube, but also that component is stronger, and the cube itself is the weakest component along the exact cube, along the texture. So these A, B, and C textures, they are all different, but the same material. With this help, we can see what differences appear in terms of formability, in terms of yield surface, when we do the whole analysis. If you look at the hardening, there are experimental hardening curves here, A, B, and C. Tensile testing, true stress, true strain. And because the textures are different and because the metallurgical state of the material is not exactly the same, you see that there are considerable differences in the hardening of the material. We approached these hardening curves here with a simple Swift law. So when there we have only the exponent n, and which is varying slightly, the strain hardening exponent for the three materials, and then the m parameter which we took, it was small, 0.01. So we have our hardening parameters for the simulation. The first thing which we did was to look at how the yield surfaces look like. So the solution was here based on very, very low small strain rate sensitivity, the Taylor model, 700 grains, and only the 111-110 slip, which is typical for aluminium. And here we plot a half of the yield surface, because it would be complete like that. This is the relevant part for biaxial stretching, and also for the tensile testing. Biaxial stretching is here, in this region, and tensile testing is here. So, the differences between the yield surfaces of the three materials are not very big, but can be relevant because the curvatures are different. For example, for equibiaxial stretching here, we see very different orientations and curvatures of the yield surface. Also here in this point there are differences. So we expect that in forming capacities there would be differences. So here is some simulation for two cases. I talked about this groove. Yeah. The groove angle, which is phi. That's the inclination, the position of this imperfection on the surface. It's supposed to be like a scratch, you know, long but we don't know how its orientation is. So we vary the orientation. And do two cases were done here when we just fix its position at 0 degree, or when it's perpendicular to the major strain at 0 degree, or when we let it vary and we find the strain which is the lowest, when the first strain localization can happen. So, whatever we look at, we see that for the biaxial stretching, the simulation curves, they show differences. So the material which is supposed to be the most deformable is the texture A, and texture C, the cube, is in between, and this texture is the smallest deformability. But on the negative side of the FLD, which is basically kind of tensile testing, there is not much differences. So all three materials are presenting the same formability. So if your application is mostly after tensile straining the material, texture effect is negligible. But it's not the case for the biaxial range. The differences can be very large. Now, here, and this is the real case, varying the groove angle. You really have to vary and find the minimum strain. That means that the minimum strain belongs to not a fixed position of the groove, so that strain will be smaller because you look for the minimum strain by varying the groove angle. So all these points we are going to move down, and we get smaller strains. We even have this kind of forming limit diagram. So, unfortunately, as you can see, texture has with the groove, decreasing effect of the forming limit. But here, we did not take into account the evolution of the texture. So we kept the texture fixed with its yield surface. And this is how we obtained that. Only the anisotropy of the material was considered. So now we are going to do with the texture evolution and compare. So this was the result with varying groove without texture evolution. And this is the case when texture evolution is taken into account. So what is the effect here? The effect will be, as you can see, that there is further decrease in the strain, especially in the biaxial. Parts are not affected. It can be shown actually that this point especially only depends on the strain hardening capacity of the material. It cannot depend on the texture, this point. So no change expected here. But in biaxial stretching, there is much more changes. And the effect of the texture is decreasing here, the formability of the material. So you had better to develop such material in which the texture evolution would not happen. But this is impossible because when you deform the material plastically, texture evolution cannot be stopped, cannot be avoided. So this is an effect which happens. Now, we look into what happened to the texture itself. So these were the initial textures before deforming. And then when we arrive to the limit strain in biaxial, equibiaxial deformation here, then The cube texture transforms into that one. The cube is still there, as we can see, but a kind of fiber is appearing here and appearing again there. This is a kind of 1-1-1 fiber here. Also for this material we get a kind of fiber texture, and also in there. The most interesting characteristic is this this fiber here. So in terms of texture evolution there are quite much, there is quite much, but the evolution of the texture is such that it is decreasing the formability of the material. Not very good news for the texture community, because of course industrials, they want high formability, so then we announce to them that, well, sorry, but texture evolution itself is decreasing formability. Then they were asking us, what textures, but texture itself can help formability, and of course it is the case, especially for hexagonal materials, and also for steel. For steel, the so-called 1-1-1 fiber texture perpendicular to the sheet is very beneficial for the formability. It belongs to a high R value, and all these FLDs are going up. In hexagonals, also, usually the R value is very high, because when we deform the sheet, it doesn't want to change its thickness. Thickness reduction is for high R value is low, and that is that means a good formability. So luckily, for as initial texture, if we have a good initial texture, we can have good formabilities. These simulations, unfortunately, I did not develop them, but here, but you can do actually yourself to find it out. But I must tell you that actually to set up this approach with the two faces, two zones in which the texture evolution is taken into account in both zones, and you obtain the deformations and then detect when deformation is localizing, it's a little bit complex. It needs a good exercise to do it. Now, confirming the texture evolution, here there is some comparison for our case, which we just studied. Biaxial hydraulic bulging testing result shows that texture evolution, what we find for this initial texture material, is going into this kind, and our simulations actually are quite similar. So this resembles very much to experimental variations. But this is expected. In general, crystal plasticity, polycrystal plasticity, is working very nicely. Now let's examine a little bit what would be the orientation of this groove. As I said, a minimization has to be done to find the lowest strain, which belongs to the safe deformation. The angle of this groove is plotted here on the vertical axis as a function of this parameter, which is the strain, which defines the strain path. So here is the stretching part, yeah, equibiaxial stretching would be right here, equibiaxial, and this is the negative part when there is mostly tension. So we see, you see that our solutions are here, our crystal plasticity solutions, and there is one theoretical which is coming from Rodney Hill, you know, the big plasticity man, where he predicted that in the negative range the angle should be arcus tangent minus rho is here, is the strain path parameter. And that, and in the biaxial setting, it should be zero. This is his prediction here. Well, actually, the polycrystal simulations confirm very nicely for the negative part, the prediction of Hill, but do not confirm his prediction for the biaxial stretching. Simply, Hill, when developing this critical angle criterion, he used isotropic material, isotropic plasticity. It's phenomenological isotropic plasticity what he had used. And this is, here there is no problem because we have no dependence on the texture anyway. So it's like isotropic. But here we have dependencies. The forming limit depends on the texture. So obviously, you know, this is the isotropic case. And the deviations from that represent the critical angle belonging to the minimum strain is deviating from the Hill's prediction. And now finally, we look at the evolution of the yield surface, the yield locus. I showed it before stretching, and this is going to be after stretching. The yield surfaces are normalized to their actual hardening state, tau c. This is why they look to be about the same size. But in reality, this one after deformation, the limit strain, is higher. But to compare the shapes and the shape changes, we normalized it. Well, one can see that the order, you know, B, A, and C didn't change. The main characteristics remained about the same. There are some small variations in differences, but not really striking. So the yield surface itself is changing, of course, and this is has an effect of the on the forming limit diagram. But it's difficult to see how these changes would affect it. Only the calculation can show that. So I make my conclusions on the application of the Marciniak-Kosinski theory when texture included in the simulations. Because all these calculations could be done analytically if you do not have polycrystal plasticity. Just taking a yield surface, its evolution by strain, all can be done by hand analytically and can be calculated. But of course, when we have the tool of polycrystal plasticity, we would like to use that, and we can get much more insight, like looking at effect of anisotropy on the critical groove angle and other things. So we could see that the forming limit depends on the initial texture, but only in the positive part of the forming limit diagram. And the critical angle is not zero in the positive part, in the stretching part of the FLD for textured materials, contrary to the prediction of Hill. And the effect is, here I say equalization. I'm making the curves more nearer to each other, but also at the same time, pushing down, I go back to show the forming limit diagrams here. So the effect, yes, one can, they are approaching. So the differences between the different textures are reduced. But not only reduced, but it's also changed to the lower values, slightly. So this is how another application can prove that a lot of information can be obtained by polycrystal plasticity. And with this, I'm arriving to the end of the theoretical part of the presentations. you had a training for the modeling basis. You learned how to understand and to calculate lattice orientation change. Different models were looked at in polycrystal plasticity, and finally you applied it on a given example. Many of you already playing with the viscoplastic code and then getting interesting results. Finally, we looked at different applications and many different aspects of large deformation of polycrystals. I hope that it was useful for you and will be useful in your future development. I wish you a good luck. Thank you.